Never before have the lives of so many changed so much, so quickly, as when the engines came to life for the very first time, with a roar that echoed over continents. In the soot and ash covering the streets, the people planted seeds of revolution. Visionaries of commerce and diplomacy electrified the world, and sparks of inspiration flew towards the sky. Up, up, over the smokestacks, rose a promise of a grand tomorrow.
Hello everybody, Realm Builder Guy here, and welcome back to the channel in a new Victoria 3 video. Man, it feels good to be able to say that. So there's more of this coming, but as most everybody knows, Victoria 3 was announced over this last weekend at PDX Con. Part of that, they had quite a few panels and discussions, and one of them dealt with the economics of Victoria 3, Vickynomics. And Paradox was kind enough to share the presentation and the slides. So I thought, why not make a quick video about it and kind of update everybody that wasn't part of that, that didn't see it, and kind of go through some of my thoughts and have a lively discussion down in the comments section. If you are enjoying these Victoria 3 updates and you enjoy this video, please don't forget to hit like. And if you are new, as many people are, because I'm still a young and growing channel, don't forget to hit subscribe so you don't miss out on any Victoria 3 content coming to the channel in future, as well as Crusader Kings 3, Stellaris, and a bunch of other games coming here to the channel. So, let's get into this presentation. So, scale. First thing on, 1 billion people at game start, whereof 800 million in subsistence economy. That basically means they're not wealthy. So that is a good reflection of society at that time. 750 plus states belonging to 140 plus markets. Markets are very, very important. Market is basically, economically, you're opening up a new market. There are common markets, there are global markets, all that kind of stuff from Victoria 2, it sounds like, and they are just expanding upon it greatly here in Victoria 3. There are 500 million pounds in GDP at game start, most of it in the private sector. There are roughly 50 building types and 50 goods types. And a note down there, updated all the time because they did say the game is in alpha stage. So it hasn't yet moved to beta. They don't expect many changes between alpha and beta, so hopefully it'll move to beta relatively soon. Overall, there's a lot of speculation as to when the game will launch. Will it still come out in 2021, or is this more a 2022 launch? I mean, in the past, given the time frame of announcement versus release, it's always about just about a year, year and a half, so that would put it in about the August-September window of 2022. They've been working on this since 2018, so I hope it actually comes much sooner than that, but I want to make sure the game is great and good to go, because we don't need a bad launch. All right, production and consumption. Buildings such as textile mills and wheat farms produce and often use various goods. States are limited in what types of resource industries they support, because of course it depends on what goods are there. Pops consume goods to maintain their wealth. Government buildings like barracks consume goods like ammunition. So you need basic raw materials, you need resources, and then of course everybody consumes things, and that's very typical on Victoria 2 as well. You know, if you're putting in military, they needed ammunition and small arms, so you need to somehow figure out how to supply them with it. Infrastructure. Actually, I like this. Looks pretty cool. Infrastructure from rivers, ports, and railways bring the world closer together, improving access to goods and movement of people. Markets are regions in which goods are freely traded, one or several countries under a single market owner. Now, one part in Victoria 2, of course, you go through technology advances and you develop your railways and your infrastructure over time. That was a very key component of Victoria 2. I assume, and by looking at this, that Victoria 3 will be no different there, especially if you look at the technological advances seen in the 19th century. This makes perfect sense. Pricing. You can see here, roughly base price. Here's the price. And is it trending? It's up. Here's a nice market graph for fruit in the American market. It was a very stable price, and then it crashed and went up a little bit. All goods have a market price based on supply and demand. States with poor market access due to underdeveloped infrastructure suffer adverse local prices. Price is everything. Underproduced goods are expensive and make you reliant on imports. Overproduced goods are cheap to buy but unprofitable to make. So it is the scale of economics of, you know, supply and demand and price. That's one thing they said in the presentation itself at PDXCon, that price is relative, because of course what benefits one hurts the other. Pop needs. Needs can be fulfilled by a variety of goods. After needs are fulfilled, any leftover money builds wealth and standard of living. Improving standard of living leads to increased population growth and turns pops into loyalists. Worsening conditions turn pops into radicals. I remember in Victoria 2, they also talked about, you know, I mean, you can be a dictatorship with a really happy population if you made everybody wealthy. And I'm assuming that's not different here. Let's look at some of this. We've got current basic food expenses, Dixie farmers in Louisiana. You can see this is what their basic expenses. This is some of the stuff that they need. And here we've got clothes, furniture, services, standard of living increasing over time. So, I mean, pop needs, you've got your basic life needs, and then you've got, you know, kind of your needs and your wants, for lack of a better term. And you need to supply the basic life needs have to be met, otherwise you're going to have problems. So that's the same mechanic that you saw in Victoria 2. Wages. Privately owned buildings have full control over their wages and try to maximize their profits. Countries control government and military wages, which benefit parts of their society. Government subsidies guarantee a good wage to keep production high. So we've got the average annual wage here. We've got logging camps in Tennessee, yearly productivity per employee, employment 15,000, cash reserves, so it's not looking too bad. Weekly taxes, and here the logging camps break down average annual wage, and you've got your laborers, machinists, engineers, and capitalists. This is how much they are on average earning. Very, very nice. Taxes. Tax your economy in various ways to make money for the treasury. You've got income taxes deducted from wages paid, poll taxes per head, consumption taxes on bought goods, dividends taxes on profits made. Who's taxed? How much depends on your laws. You've got your consumption taxes here, dividends tax, and how that all breaks into your national revenue. And of course, depending on who you tax or what you tax, I assume will have an impact on the happiness of your pops. Trade. Use your trading fleet to import and export goods with allies and rivals alike. Export goods you have a competitive advantage to manufacture. Import resources you lack or manufactured goods your people need. Trade routes can be mutually beneficial or aggressive. So what looks here, you're using trade as a key diplomatic factor to also antagonize people if need be. I like that. And that is very, very true to history. The economic system. As one of the many types of laws you can change, the country's economic system drastically changes your play style. Imports are penalized under mercantilism. Isolationist countries aim for self-sufficiency. Under free trade, pop investments are plentiful, but subsidies are limited. So what we have here, we've got a command economy, free trade, agrarianism, mercantilism, isolationism, and traditionalism. These are the different economic system policies it looks like that you can enact or reforms, depending on how they name it. Conclusion, your economy is not only your country's engine, but also shapes your population. Access to cheap resources and captive markets influence diplomacy. All actions reverberate through the economy, creating new economic and political challenges. Yeah, so this is your first look at the basic mechanics of economy that will go into Victoria 3. It's looking really promising. Of course, we're going to get more details here over time. knowing how, you know, the economy worked in Victoria 2, this looks like it's Victoria 2 Plus. They're definitely expanding on a lot of different areas graphically. It just looks way better. But I'm seeing a lot of similarities. Of course, we're going to find out more as the dev diaries come out, as we actually see gameplay footage, and hopefully one day actually get to play the game. So let me know your thoughts down in the comments on what you've seen so far in the economy of Victoria 3. What has you most excited? What has you most concerned? And what mechanics do you think are the most critical? So until next time, I'm Realm Builder Guy. Don't forget to hit like, subscribe, and check out all the links down in the description. Talk to you soon. Bye.